see life a certain way. Even if they're Christian or not Christian, you can learn a lot from them. And then you can look at the spiritual component. And one thing that got me was Babe Ruth. You know, for a long time, obviously he had the home run record, but he also had the strikeout record. He struck out more than anybody else. But one thing he said, you know, the fear from striking out never keeps me from swinging. I love that.
Yeah.
I just love that. Because every time, if you watches the him get up the bat, he was always swinging to hit it out of the park.
Yeah.
He didn't have, I mean, he got up there and he swung. So sometimes he's going to strike out and sometimes he's going to hit a home run. But he was always planted. And as Christians, that's where we need to be every moment of our life.
Yeah.
That every time we get
for me. Never done this by myself. So, all right, let's praise the Lord tonight.
We wait for you. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand clap tonight. Thank the Lord. Praise God. God is great. Amen. God bless you. I appreciate you of you being here tonight. Amen. Thank you, Tim, for opening. And thank you, Roberto. This is difficult. I know generally we have more people on the platform than we have in the church tonight. Hallelujah. But wherever two or more are gathered together, Lord's in the midst, hallelujah, and we'll just go ahead and have church, praise God. This is all about the Lord, and he knows, hallelujah. So thank you, everybody, for coming out. Appreciate you being here. Thank you for worshiping and sharing with us and giving us the opportunity to pray with you and for your needs. And let Roberto get up to the platform, because he's doing like triple duty tonight. And once he's up there and able to get the technology running here, which I know absolutely nothing about. I just read it and hope that it's where it's supposed to be when it's supposed to be there. Praise the Lord. But I've got a very simple and brief message tonight to be sensitive to everybody's time. I know most all got to get up and go to work in the morning, except for those of us who are accused of only working 2 days a week anyway. It's no big deal. Praise the Lord. But amen. God is good. And I appreciate the words that were shared tonight, because it does deal directly with the simple little message I do want to share with you. And it is about how, you know, we view things, past, present, future, and how that impacts us and creates situations in our lives that can be negative a lot of times. If we could only see from God's perspective, He's the same. He's always with us. Amen. And He never changes. So we'll get right into it. If you would, Roberto, let's begin with Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 8. Thank the Lord. God is so good, amen, and faithful to meet every need if we can just believe. You know, if thou canst believe, all things are possible. And that's the reality. We just have to continue to remind ourselves that our situations and circumstances are all temporary. The Word of God is permanent. It's forever settled, amen. And it could be settled here if we'll just agree with Him, amen. So Jesus Christ, the same, yesterday and today and forever. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right, Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13. For as God which worketh in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. I'm glad for that scripture. Amen. It's not up to me. It's up to God. Hallelujah. For God to will is to do. I'll repeat that. For God to will is to do. If God wills it, it's done. Amen. His relationship to time. Now, when we think about this, for God to will to do. Now, that's unusual. We can have a will to do a lot of things, but we don't always get it done, right? But when God wills to do something, it's as good as done. All right? And that's kind of radical for us to think that way. But if you think in terms of his time, His relationship to time is pretty radical as well, because it's so different from ours. We're in time. Everything about us is time. From the moment we're born, we're measuring time all the time. It's always kind of linear. We're always looking at it this, and this. You see timelines all the time for everything. But that's just the way we are. That's not the way God is. God acts in time, but He doesn't relate to time the same way that we do. And that causes problems for us a lot of times. So He acts in time, but He doesn't relate to time in any way that we can relate to, that we could understand. And that can become confusing. Now look at this in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. Now, we don't relate that way, but that's exactly how God looks at it. In other words, time doesn't mean anything to God, not in the way that it does to us. So I just say that my grandmother was born before the automobile. The horse and buggies were the primary mode of transportation when she was a kid. By the time she died, astronauts had walked on the moon. Now, that's pretty amazing to me. When I was small, she was younger than I am now. And yet, by a child's standard, she seemed ancient. For one thing, she looked old. I don't say anything, praise the Lord. But when she lectured us about manners, her sense of etiquette came from the 19th century. It was totally unlike norm for us as kids. But it was her relationship to technology that really persuaded me that my grandmother was ancient. She never drove. She never had a driver's license. She never drove a car. She was just totally unlike what you think of as normal for today. She lived in a house, her and my grandfather, with no bathroom. They bathed in a washtub on the back porch. They were good people, hardworking people, but that's the way it was. And really, a visit to my grandparents, and we loved going there. It was the best place in the world. It was the most fun. It was a great time. But it was like going back in time. It was really like stepping into a time warp when we'd go and stay with them. And now, I'm the one who has to seem ancient or at least old-fashioned to my grandchildren. Mm-hmm. Last week, the youngest grandchildren were over at the house, and my granddaughter just turned 5, and this grandson is 4, and then there's another one that's 3, but the 4-year-old was sitting on one knee, and the 5-year-old was on the other, and the 4-year-old said, "Grandpa," or Popo is what he calls me. He says, "Popo, are you old?" I said, "Well, kinda. I mean," and Izzy, the granddaughter, she said, "Yeah, he's old, and so's Nana." But the saving grace was, then Bubba, he said, "Yeah, but my great-grandma on the other side," he said, "my great-grandma, she's really old." So maybe I felt a little better. But, I am old, relatively speaking. I mean, you can always find somebody that's older. At least so far I've been able to. But I remember when you could, the only way you could see a movie was going to the theater. Yeah. I was like, 6, 8 years old before we had television. And even then, you had like one channel, Ames, and 3/4 of the time it was just a test pattern. We sat there and watched it like it was really something special, you know. But if you wanted to see a movie, you had to go into downtown Des Moines to the theater. The old Paramount or the RKO or some of the theaters that used to be downtown. That's the only way it could happen. I listened to music on a record player. They called them hi-fis, but just a record player, mono, you know. Advanced technology was FM radio. That was the big deal. Remember the song FM, no static at all. Praise the Lord. But to talk to somebody far away, you had to dial a thing and go through the long-distance operator, or you had to write a letter. Snail mail, they call it now, but that was the only way you were going to communicate with anybody. It was a time the only person that had anything like a smartphone was Dick Tracy, and he was only in the comics. That's the reality. Now, look at Luke chapter 5 and verse 39. This may not make any sense to you, but I'm just trying to show you how we look at time one way, and God looks at it altogether different. "No man also having drunk of old wine straightway desireth new, for he saith the old is better." Now, Jesus' observation here is also, it's often true when it comes to technology. I know it is with me. I've got a cell phone, a flip phone, and everybody's calling me a dinosaur all the time because they've got these smartphones and stuff, and they can do GPS on it, and they can download and things. And I just got to the point about 3-4 years ago. I got the same phone I've had for 4 or 5 years now. They keep wanting me to trade it in, but I've just learned how to use it, so I'm not going to do that. But I just got one where I can finally take a picture of, you know, with somebody on my phone. And it's just a pretty simple flip phone in comparison to most of the phones that you see that are out there now, where they can scroll stuff, they can download stuff, they can watch TV on it, they can download movies and everything else. I'm not against it. I'm just saying it's just too much work for me. I don't have time to learn all that stuff. So if I can call somebody and they can call me, that's good. That's all I need, really. Text message occasionally, but I screw all those up too, so I try not to get too involved. But what I'm saying is that nobody wants new wine after drinking old wine, and that's kind of true with technology in a lot of cases. If we're comfortable with the technology we already have, we often say that old is better. That's where my grandmother was. She was happy to walk 100 yards back to the outdoor toilet rather than have one in the house. Didn't bother her to haul water into a big wash tub and bathe in it, or my grandfather, or all of us grandkids when we'd come up there. We loved it because that meant it was only one bath a week on Saturday night, and it was great, you know. So we were happy. But I'm just saying, we get used to what's old, and we don't really want the new. We think the old is better because that's what we're used to. That's what we're comfortable with. But with God, the Scripture, it conflates the past, the present, and the future. And let me give you an example. In Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, we're always thinking old, current, and future, right? Remember those movies, Back to the Future and all that stuff. But we're always thinking that's past, this is what we're at right now, and then there's a thing coming up. But here in Revelation, he says, "And all that dwell upon the earth worship him whose names are not written in the book of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world." Typically, we think Jesus was slain 2,000 years ago, but in the mind of God, he was slain before the world ever even existed. Try to make sense out of that in a natural way. It doesn't make sense to us because of our consideration of time, where God acts in time, but he isn't bound by it. He doesn't deal with it in any normal human way, I should say. So look at Matthew now, Matthew chapter 25 and verse 34. I hope I'm not just confusing you. What I'm trying to do is show you that God, his ways are different than our ways. And we have to have our minds renewed to the way he does things in order to really be able to experience the things that God wants us to experience and to react and relate to things in this world the way he wants us. We're in this world, but we're not of this world. Now, it's easy to say, but it's not so easy to keep a conscious flow that really works in that reality, right? So then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, "Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." So again, see, the work of God does in the present bring what God has purposed in eternity past. So we talk about healing. We were talking about it tonight. We all do this. I do it. I'm saying I want my wife healed when in fact she was already healed. You know, and that's what I mean. We struggle with the reality that God is in and the reality that we're in. So we have to constantly remind ourselves that the work that God does in the present, the healing that takes place now, the deliverance that takes place now, the financial breakthrough that takes place now, the revelation that comes to us now in the present, God has purposed in eternity past into the realm of our experience. He knew us before we ever existed. Before our parents, our grandparents, my grandmother, with all of her, what seemed to be ancient and old, the Ancient of Days knew her and knew me in her thousands of years before any human, before Adam and Eve were here. God already knew me. Wrap your mind around that for a minute. That's what I'm saying. We don't think in terms of time the way God does, because he's timeless. He knows the end from the beginning. He has no end nor beginning. Amen? So, viewed from the perspective of our experience, it's a new thing or a yet-to-be-accomplished thing. Healing. I'll just use that as an example. See, from my perspective, just speaking naturally now, the healing is something that's coming. You know, we even say things like we're looking for the manifestation. And it's just another way of, you know, trying to spiritualize the fact that I'm waiting on it. When in fact, it was already done. It's accomplished. It's finished. But from a human perspective, in this world, we're still seeing it as something that's going to happen, not something that happened thousands of years ago. By his stripes, we were healed. Amen? Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10. So I just want to challenge us to try to think spiritually. Think the way we really are. Because what we truly are spirit beings. I mean, we have flesh. We have to have a body to be legal to operate down here on the earth. But we're spirits. We've been born again. We are spirit beings. And we have to operate from that reality. This spirit that we're talking about, who we really are, who we truly are, It's timeless. It's eternal. It's going to live forever. And that forever is not a long time. It's timeless. There's no end. That's hard to think about, you know, that it's not a long, 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 how many longs you want to put in there, time. It's without time. Give me a headache just thinking about it now. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Let's look at this. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Right? This the fact of that scripture makes God's rest in Genesis, where he finished everything and then he rested, right? He said, it's all good, and then he takes a break. That is the fountainhead of all rest. In other words, it makes God's rest the starting point for all of us. Amen? In other words, we don't have to strive. We don't have to struggle to do the good works that were already foreordained. We're supposed to rest in the work that God has done, that he has already accomplished. Whether that's healing, whether it's deliverance, whether it's whatever it might be. You get the correlation here. That's what we're trying to understand, and what God is trying to reveal to us is we are to rest in his finished work. Jesus said, it's finished. Well, it was. But in another sense, in the God sense, it was finished before the foundation of the world. It was already done. So the good works that we do are those that God prepared in advance for us to do. Healing, again. We think it's, well, somebody's going to lay hands on somebody, they're going to get healed. All we're doing is agreeing with what God has already done. We're not making something happen. We're just agreeing with the fact that it has happened. I know you're out there. I can hear you breathing. Praise the Lord. See, work and rest both begin and end with God. He does the work. He rested. We rest in his work. That's our trust in what God has done. That's called faith. It's believing that God has accomplished everything that we need. Amen? Look at this in Luke chapter 12, verse 29 through 32. Luke 12, 29 through 32. Now, this is a good example because now it's talking about one thing, but actually this is talking about everything. I mean, it's not just about food, drink, and clothes. It's about whatever our need might be. So that includes healing. That includes, you know, financial breakthroughs. That includes, you know, relational issues. Everything is all, you know, summarized here. Seek not ye what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, neither be ye doubtful of mine. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Now, that just seems counterintuitive in a way, because he, on the one hand, he's saying, look, I already know you need a financial break here. I already know you need healing. I already know you need this or that or this thing fixed or whatever it might be. So seek the kingdom. And then he says, I just enjoy giving you the kingdom. Right? So on the one hand, we're seeking the kingdom, and all he wants to do is just give us the kingdom anyhow. But the idea is not so much the pursuit of, it's the trust of. Because if we trust in this kingdom, God gives us everything that is a part of the kingdom, which is your inheritance, which is all that you have need of, whatever that need might be at any given time throughout your life. Praise the Lord. Now, here's the deal. The kingdom that he's talking about, Christ's kingdom, is the point where the past, the present, and the future ultimately converge. It's where everything God has done comes to where we are, and everything from the future comes as well. So my point is this. God, the kingdom is like God's perspective. It's timeless. So the past, the present, and the future all collide in the kingdom of God. What God has foreordained, what our need is today, and what the future holds. It's all in the kingdom. It's all provided for. The purpose for that is so that we rest. We don't fret about the past that we can't do anything about. We don't freak out about the present, which looks like totally out of our control. And we don't worry about the future that we're not sure of. Because he's got it all taken care of. In the kingdom, the king is in charge. In the kingdom, the king is in control. And the king provides for all of his kingdom. Amen? That's the idea behind this. Look at Revelation 22, verses 1 through 3. Revelation 22, 1 through 3. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her every fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. Now, in our experience as believers, the current of Christ's kingdom operates bi-directionally. Now, we're talking about there's a river that flows, right? But as human beings on this planet, our experience, the way that we actually relate as believers, the current or the river that flows from the kingdom of Christ operates, again, bi-directionally. In other words, it flows forward and links us to the horizon today, and also to the horizon of the future. But it also moves backwards because it draws everything into its power. Do you understand what I'm saying? This thing, this river isn't like a river that just flows from here to there. It's flowing that way, it's flowing this way, because it pulls everything together. The past, the present, and the future are all under the control and the power of God. They're not separate things. The current of God's grace redeems our past, our present, and our future. Everything is a part of this river of God, this kingdom of God. Amen? John chapter 15 and verse 5. We're abide, he says, in the vine. Because you can't do it yourself. You have to stick with the vine if you're going to produce anything, right? John 15, 5. I'm the vine, you're the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. But without me, you can't do anything. Okay, so we produce fruit, but we don't manufacture fruit. We can't create fruit. We can only produce fruit. Why? Because he already manufactured it before the foundation of the world. And if we stay abiding in him, if we look to the kingdom, if we seek the kingdom, the fruit produces automatically as a result, which is, again, healing and deliverance and whatever it is that you have need of. All right? We think of rest as something that we're going to do. Right? I mean, we think of rest as something we're going to do. It's another kind of work. We're going to work to rest, right? It's like better technology. We had the old technology, which was work, 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 work. Now we have this new technology, which is rest in what God has done. And we think it's just a different way of working. So just a better technology, right? a different way of doing our work. Then just think about the computer. I saw something the other day that just blew my mind. Now, we go to the Amanas every once in a while, probably once a year or at least every other year. I don't know why, because it's the same stuff, but we just go back because it's kind of cool. But, you know, no electricity, a lot of no automobiles, just horse and buggy and so forth. Everything's pretty much done manually or by horsepower. I mean, individual horses. But I saw something that just blew my mind. The Amish sell furniture over the internet. I have a problem with that. I mean, I don't care. But it's just like, I don't know how they justify the kind of the two things there. But apparently they had a view, you know, a vision for the future. Even though they're by all of our standards, they're living in the past. Right? See what I mean? There's this contradiction in all of us. Because they had a vision for the future, but rest allows a different kind of vision. Even they are dealing with this time stuff that just makes no sense. So look at this, Genesis chapter 28, verse 16. This will be the last scripture. We'll wrap up here pretty quick. Genesis 28, verse 16. This is Jacob. He's been, you know, or not, yeah, it's Jacob, but he's been trying to get back to the, you know, his own kind of way of doing things. He falls asleep on a rock. Jacob wakes up out of his sleep, and he said, "Surely the Lord is in this place." You know, he saw the ladder. Jacob's ladder, they talk about leading up to heaven, angels ascending and descending from the ladder. Well, this is it. Jacob wakes out of his sleep, and he said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not." Now, here's the point of all this. Just like Jacob wakes up from this sleep, we look at our lives in a larger context. We look at it past, present, and future. But the Lord, as has been said many times already tonight, is already present. He's always present. We just weren't aware. We just weren't awake to the fact that he was here, that he's always here. See, the great transformation of us can only be seen in part if it's viewed from the present, from the current vantage point. You understand what I'm saying? We can say, yeah, I know, I'm not what I want to be, but I'm not what I used to be. But we are what God has already declared us to be. We are the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. But we can't see but from a very limited perspective. And that's why we have to start looking at things the way God sees it, in order to receive everything that God has already done for us. It is finished work, including us. It just doesn't look finished from our perspective. Right? But when God looks at us, he sees a finished work. He sees Christ. He sees us through the blood of Christ. Perfect. Without spot, without wrinkle. He sees us healed. He sees us prospered. Amen? He sees us righteous. Thank the Lord. Amen. I want to see what God sees. I want to have what God has already paid for, what God has already purchased, what he's already done. See, the radical pursuit of rest is a way of looking at the past and the present as it is a perspective on the future. By it, we learn to surrender to the omnipresent God. Our past, our present, and our future. He's in all of them. Because there is no time for God. Only us. When we get to tomorrow, God's already there. If we could go back to yesterday, he'd still be there. And certainly where we are right this moment, he's here. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Age is not the enemy. Not even the passage of time. The enemy is the distraction of what has been or what might be. Can I get a witness? That's what the devil wants us to deal with. What could have been, what was, and what might be. Instead of what is. And God said, I am. And he am yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. Wherever we are, wherever we've been, wherever we go, I am. I am your healer. I am your deliverer. I am your savior. I am your king. Hallelujah. I'm your heavenly father. And you are my beloved, in whom I am well pleased. Amen. Yesterday, today, and forever. That's the perspective we have to get. A God perspective. And it's possible to see things the way he sees it through this. All of his promises, he said, in him are yea and amen. And all of these promises make it able for us to be conformed to his image. Amen. Timeless. Victorious. Hallelujah. Can you give the Lord a hand tonight? Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen, amen. Again, God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here. And let's try to think timeless, okay? Because I really think it's the key. It's what's going to see what, if I can use the natural term again, to see manifestation, you have to see it as accomplished. You have to see it as a finished work, no matter what it is. It's all been done, and it's all been done perfectly. Let's just rest in what God has done. He's not nervous. He's resting. Praise the Lord, because he's done everything that needs to be done. Amen. God bless you again. Thanks for being here tonight. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Drive careful going home. Watch out for me. I'll be in the great pickup.